So firstly, what is Git? Git, as Linus say, it's like a file system. So like a file system, you can find some file, but the name of the file, it's a blob. And some tree, so some directory, and the name in Git, it's a tree. So for all of this is your file system. And we explain each object of the Git. So firstly, we have the blob. So the blob is like your file in your file system. And each blob contains entirely your file. And at the beginning, we have a Git header, like the kind of the Git object. So it's a blob. And after, we have the length of the Git object. And so we can see the OCaml code. It's come from Engstrom library to describe how to decode something. And we have the EBNF syntax below. So from this, we serialize the blob. So we take the header and we take entirely of your file. We put all in the hash implementation. And the hash implementation gets you a unique identifier. So it's a hash like the SHA-1, because if you use Git, you know we use the SHA-1. And because we have the header in the first part, it's why when you get the SHA-1 directly of your file, you cannot get the same hash value of the hash value from Git. So just these things. So after, to identify your blob, it's like you use the SHA-1. And currently in OCaml Git, you can use the SHA-1, but if you don't know, we break the SHA-1. So now the plan in Git is to move to the black to be hash function, but in Git we already think about that, and you can switch to your hash implementation, and currently we use the SHA-256. So after we have the tree. As I said, the tree is like a directory, so it's just a list of entry which describe each file on your directory and each subdirectory on your directory. So for each entry, we have the permission, is like the kind of the object. So it's a directory, a Git link, a file, or something like this. And the permission, like if we can write or execute the file. And after, we have the name of the entry, so like the file name or the name of the directory. And we have the unique identifier, so the hash of the Git object. So this is a little example. So for example, we have one directory and one file, and from this we can have this tree. So the permission, with the permission we can recognize if it's a directory or file, and after the name and the function, the hash identifier. So for all of this, when you want to update, like you Git add something, so for example, we have a blob with a specific hash, and we change it. So we generate a new hash of this blob, so a new unique identifier. We need to change the tree which contains the blob, because it contains the old hash identifier. So we need to change it to the new hash identifier to the file. But because we change the hash value, we change the hash of the tree again. And again, the directory which contain your blob will change too, because we change the hash of the tree. So we need to change the hash of the tree which contain the blob. And after, we change the hash identifier of the root tree, which contains the directory, which contains your blob. So for all of this, we check the integrity of your file system. So any changement in your file system, in your repository, need to update any hash for any changement. It's not like, it's like a cascading. So when you Git add, it's not like just put a new blob in your file system, in your Git repository. It's like we put a new blob and we put all three which depend on your blob. So we have the snapshot of your file system with the Merkle tree. So we have some hash and we compose this hash and we derive the final hash of the root tree, and after we have the commit. So the commit is like we save one time the snapshot of your file system. So a commit is really simply we have the tree root, it's like the root of your repository. After we have the parent, it's like where come from this commit. So it comes from some other commit. So the common thing is like it comes from one commit, but when you merge a commit, it's like it comes from two commits. And after we have the author and the committer and the message in the commit. And again, it's like a blockchain for Bitcoin and Ethereum and something like this, because for each commit, we have the link to the previous commit, like the blockchain, because in the Bitcoin, for each blockchain block, we have the hash identifier, but it's not the same hash, but it's the same thing to the previous block. And as you see, the first commit, the last commit point to two previous commits. It's like a merging of two commits. And I took the elephant because the commit remember all of your history and check again the integrity of your history. So about all of this link, because we did the link between the tree, the blob, and the commit, we can consider a Git like a graph. It's like a big graph. And I show you, so it's a little graph, not so big. And it's a specific Git repository. If you want to clone this Git repository, you could have a problem with Git and you could have a seg fault. So it's a bug now. Maybe you see in Reddit and Hacker News. But the thing is like in the top, we have three commits. And after we have the tree root. And because the hash identifier is unique, it's like if you want to move, for example, a file from a directory to another directory, it's not like we create a new blob, because it's exactly the same file. So we produce the same hash from the same blob. So when you move a blob, it's just like we change the tree which contains the blob, so we delete the blob from one entry and we put the new entry in the new in the tree with the same blob. And it's why you can see for the three tree root, this tree root point to the same tree. It's like we have nine directories, but point to the same value of directories. And again, this tree point to nine other directories and point to the same value of the directories, and again and again and again. And finally, we have nine files, so because we have nine links, which contain exactly the same value, like it's just a hello world. And because so it's an exponential directory, so it's like nine directory. And yeah, it shows you we reuse the Git object, and after we can manipulate the Git graph, the Git repository like a graph. So obviously, OCaml Git can clone this Git repository and not Git. So it's a good news. And yeah, it's like a bomb for Git. So because we identify each snapshot of your file system, of your Git repository by the SHA-1, it's not very convenient for human people to remember about which SHA-1 I use, so it's a little bit complex, and it's why we use the reference. And the reference is just a human readable value which contains the hash to the commit, or another reference which contains the hash of the commit, etc., etc. So, but the problem of reference, it's the only mutable value of your Git repository. So we need to protect against the input-output computation. So in OCaml Git, you just need to get an implementation of lock, and after we use it to protect the reference. So it's an example where when we mutate the value of reference, you git add some file. After you git at this step, you have a hash on the head reference, and when you commit, the head reference will be updated with the new hash of your last commit. So it's the point. So this is the big things about Git, but now we will explain what we have under the hood. So how to store the Git object with Git. So the first one is like the loose file. The loose file is like, okay, we have a Git object, so it's a tree, but we doesn't care. With OCaml Git, we serialize the tree, so we have an OCaml value and we create a raw data from the tree. And after, we need to compress to deflate the raw data, so we have an implementation of zlib in pure OCaml, and with this implementation, we'll create so a compressed value of the tree. And after, we just need to move on this file to this directory. So as you can see, the first byte, the hexadecimal value of the first byte of the hash seems to be the directory. And after, we have the rest of the hash. And when you want to get a Git object, it's like just take the first byte, go to the directory, do a binary search for each file inside the directory and find your Git object. So it's a really fast things, and it's like a Radix tree, a Radix things. A Radix things is like we have the key like a string, and we want to balance the left part and the right part from a specific byte of the string. And when you have a lot of Git object, like a lot of hash key, it's like, okay, the Radix tree balance the tree on the first byte. So it's why we use this like this. And after, so we have the Git object, but we have another way to store the Git object. It's the pack file. So this is what you have at the first time. When you clone a Git repository, you don't have any loose object. The loose object appear only when you add something, when you work with your Git repository. But the first, you have the pack file. And the pack file is just a list of each Git object. And to get it, you just need to extract the entry, and after, inflate the entry, and you have the Git object, and you can deserialize the Git object. But one of our things about the pack file, it's about compression, because if we, for example, if you put like a movie or image in your Git repository, it's like in your pack file, you have entirely the image or entirely the movie in the pack file, and it's too big. So we do, inside the pack file, we do a deltaification. A deltaification is like we have a list of hunk, and in the header of the pack entry, we have a source like, okay, this list of hunk need to get this Git object. So it's like a Git object referenced by a hash or a relative offset. So if it's relative offset, it's like, okay, you come back n bytes before and you can find the Git object. And from the source and from the list of hunk, we can get some part of the source. So in green, you have the insert block, it's like some raw data. And in red, we have the copy block. It's like a reference to some part of the source file. And we do the deltaification, is like we copy the green part and we take the blue part and copy it, and after we generate regenerate the Git object. So it's like a big diff, but an optimized diff, not like a patience diff or something like this. It's like a diff on the byte. So it's why the pack file is very small. And one other thing about the pack file is when we try to deltaify some Git object, it's not like we take the first Git blob as you make it and try to deltaify with the new version. It's like we take the last blob and we deltaify with the oldest, because we think the biggest file is more optimized to get entirely the biggest file and do the deltaification with the smallest file, because you can find the small all the part of the smallest file inside the biggest file. So when you deltaify, it's like the smallest file, it's just a list of copy, so the smallest things. And after, we can talk about the protocol. So the protocol is little bit, it's not so complicated. When you push, it's like you ask to the server what he have. So he show you some reference and the hash binding on the reference. And after, you just need to explain what you want. So you have three action, like an update, a create, or delete. So update is like, okay, we have the same reference and I want to update this reference to this new commit. The create is to create a new reference, and delete is to delete one of them. So after, you need to compute two sets of commits. The first one is the set of all of your commits, and the second one is the set of all commits reachable by the last commit of the server. So it's like the server show you the last commit it has, and after by the parents, show before, the parents commit, you create a set, and from these two sets you make a diff. So this is all of your commits, the commit which you can find in the server, and in red it's all of commit which the server does not have. And from this diff you create a new set, so it's like just a set diff, and you make a packed stream like just before, so with deltaification, etc., etc., and send it to the server. And from the other side, so the server to the client, so at the beginning it's the same. The server say to you what he has, and after you just explain what you want. So you want some specific hash, you just need to compare the hash in your head reference with the hash of the head reference in the server, and if it's different, it's like, okay, maybe it's more updated than me. And we start a negotiation engine between the server and the client. The negotiation engine is like, okay, I will say what I have to the server, and the server respond by continue, and the server feel what I have in the side. And after, at the end, when he find the best common place between you and what he has, he send you a ready and send you the pack stream, so the pack file again. So it's like we try to find what we have together, and after when we have this together, we do the diff again, like the push command, and send it. The thing is like for the push request, we don't think about, sometimes you can sometimes you send some commit which the server has already, but it doesn't care because it's okay. But from the other side, so to the server, from the server to the client, is like, okay, we want to optimize the pack file and send exactly what you want, and not have two times the same object in your side and in the pack file. So for all of this, we implement all of this in our Camel Git. So we implement the clone, the fetch, the pull. Clone and pull, it's just a specific case of the fetch command. The push command, we implement all things about Git. So we can have a little a new command line of Git if you want. So some projects use already OCaml Git. We have Tezos. It's about crypto money. It's not exactly a crypto money, but about a smart contract. And use OCaml Git to have the Merkle tree, because Git, it's a Merkle tree, and simulate the choice between each operation, each server, and simulate by Git. And after, we have the Unikernel project, and specifically the Mirage OS project. So it's Unikernel in OCaml. And the IRM project is like a KV store in top of Git. So the things about that is to have a unikernel which store your Git repository. And after, you can have some ID like a replication server, like a backup system. So you just have a server which contains only Git, only OCaml Git, and put what you have in this server like a backup. For me, it's like I would like to make a storage server for email, but we can do a BitTorrent enhancement server and do a replication between them, and something with Mirage OS, so the unikernel. And if you want a new Git command line, but it's still difficult to do this. So, yeah. See if you have any questions.